So hello everyone, today's topic is about oral mucous membrane. Okay, there are a lot of questions from this topic, so you should understand the concept. Okay, so here, what is oral mucous membrane? So what are mucous membranes? So mucous membranes are the covering. Mucous membrane is a covering that is seen on the body cavities. So the body cavities that are communicating with the external surfaces are lined by these mucous membranes. So these mucous membranes are the coverings of the body cavities. So oral mucous membrane is lining the oral cavity. So now this oral mucosa is continuous with the skin of the lip. So anteriorly there is skin of the lip and posteriorly there is pharynx, isn't it? So the oral mucosa is continuous with the skin of the lip anteriorly, whereas posteriorly it is continuous with the mucosa of the pharynx. Okay, so now here you can see this is all the covering of the mucous membrane. So anteriorly there is lip, whereas posteriorly we have the pharynx. Okay, so this oral mucosa is different in different regions. So based on the functional adaptation, oral mucosa structure differs. So if suppose the areas that are involved in mastication, for example, the gingiva and hard palate, they have a different structure when compared to the floor of the mouth or the cheek or the lips. Okay, so depending upon the function that is needed, the oral mucosa structure also differs. Okay, so based on these functional criteria, so this classification is based on functional criteria. So based on the functional criteria, the oral mucous membrane, the oral mucosa is divided into three main regions. The first one is a masticatory mucosa, which lines the gingiva and the hard palate. So this masticatory mucosa, so if you can imagine, the gingiva and hard palate both are bound to bone. Okay, they are attached to bone. Okay, they do not stretch. They are bound to the bone. They are attached to the bone. So they bear forces, this gingiva and hard palate, they bear forces when the food is chewed. So whatever the masticatory forces, they are borne by this masticatory mucosa. Okay, so their oral mucosa is different. Whereas the second type of oral mucosa is lining or reflecting mucosa. In this, we have lip, cheek, vestibular fornix, alveolar mucosa, floor of the mouth, and soft palate. So this lining mucosa is covering musculature, isn't it? The masticatory mucosa is firmly bound to the bone, whereas the lining mucosa, it is covering the musculature and it can stretch. The masticatory mucosa cannot stretch, whereas the lining mucosa can stretch. So it adapts itself to the contraction and relaxation that is created by the underneath musculature. Okay, so this is a functional criteria based on which the classification is given. The last type is specialized mucosa. Specialized mucosa, we have the dorsum of the tongue and taste buds. This specialized mucosa is also called as sensory mucosa. So this dorsum of the tongue are having the taste buds, which are having the sensory function. So therefore, the specialized mucosa is also called as sensory mucosa. Okay, so it's specialized in that it is having a sensory function, which is the sensory function is because of the taste buds. Okay, so masticatory mucosa, we have the gingiva and hard palate. Lining or reflecting mucosa, we have the lip, cheek, vestibular fornix, alveolar mucosa, floor of the mouth, and soft palate. Specialized mucosa, we have the dorsum of the tongue and taste buds. Okay, so one MCQ given here is the floor of the epithelium and the interior surface of the tongue have the thinnest epithelium. You need to remember this. So floor of the mouth and the inferior surface of the tongue are having the thinnest epithelium. Okay. So now, what are the functions of oral mucosa? The first function is defense. So the oral cavity is an ideal incubator. It's an ideal incubator for different kinds of microorganisms. So the organisms that are present in the oral cavity are usually commensal organisms, but they have the ability to become pathogenic if the host defense is compromised. So if there is some disturbance in the host defense, these microorganisms, these commensal organisms, they will become pathogenic. So now the oral epithelium, which is present, if it is good, if its integrity is maintained, then there will be health. It acts as a barrier for different kinds of microorganisms. Okay, so oral cavity is an ideal incubator for different kinds of microorganisms. If there is epithelial integrity, if this mucous membrane is well maintained, then only the bacterial invasion will be stopped. Okay, so next one is lubrication. So we have salivary glands in the oral cavity. right? So these salivary glands will keep the oral cavity moist, okay? They will prevent the mucosa from drying up, and they will also prevent the cracking. Okay, so because of these salivary gland secretions, the oral cavity is becoming moist. So what is the need of oral cavity? What is the use of oral cavity being moist? If it is moist, it will help in the speech. It will help in speech. It will help in mastication. It will help in swallowing. And even in the perception of taste. Okay, since the oral mucosal epithelium is intact, its epithelial integrity is maintained. Therefore, we have the important function that is called as defense mechanism. Okay, the second one is lubrication, in which the oral mucosal epithelium is being moist so that it is helping in speech, mastication, swallowing, and perception of taste. Next one, it is sensory. We all know this sensory function is because of the taste buds, right? So the sensation of the sensation is better appreciated in the anterior region of the tongue. Okay, anterior two-thirds of the tongue. So the oral mucosa, especially mains, the sensory function is more in case of anterior two-thirds of the tongue, whereas the oral mucosa is sensitive to different sensations like the touch, pressure, pain, and temperature. Okay, the sensation of taste is mainly perceived in the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. The last function of oral mucosa is protection. So this oral mucosa, it's a lining, right? It is lining a body. It is lining the oral cavity. So it is protecting the deeper tissues, right? So anything which is lining, the lining is present in order to protect the deeper tissues. So the oral mucosa lining is protecting the deeper tissues. So now, in this oral mucous membrane, we will study under the headings like epithelium, connective tissue, and submucosa. If you understand this basic concept, then you will be able to understand the whole chapter. Okay, so first is epithelium. So you know the epithelium is the superficial layer, right? So this epithelium may be orthokeratinized, parakeratinized, or non-keratinized. So based on the keratinization process, the epithelium may be orthokeratinized, parakeratinized, or non-keratinized. So beneath the epithelium, so in this epithelium, so this is the basal layer of the epithelium. So in this epithelium, we have different layers, which I will talk about later. So based on the keratinization function, we have orthokeratinized, parakeratinized, or non-keratinized. So we'll see about each one later. So now beneath the epithelium, we have lamina propria. Lamina propria means connective tissue. Okay. So, and this, there is submucous layer. In this submucous layer, we have nerves, we have blood vessels, we have the minor salivary glands. Okay. So with the help of this submucous layer, there is attachment to the periosteum and bone. So this submucous layer is forming an intervening layer wherein it helps in the attachment to the periosteum or bone. Okay. So here we need to understand an important difference. Here is intestinal mucosa. Here we have the oral mucosa. So the difference in between these two is here in the oral mucosa, we have the epithelium. We have the connective tissue. We have the submucosa. Okay. Lamina propria means connective tissue. Whereas in the intestinal mucosa, same. We have the epithelium. We have the lamina propria, we have the submucosa, but in between the epithelium and the submucosa, in between this epithelium connective tissue and the submucosa, there is another layer called as muscularis mucosae. Okay, so this intervening layer is having the smooth muscle and elastic fibers. So this muscularis mucosae is absent in case of oral mucosa. So this is the important difference you need to understand. In between oral mucosa and intestinal mucosa, the intestinal mucosa is having a separate layer called as muscularis mucosae, wherein the smooth muscles and elastic fibers are present. Okay, so now we have a basement membrane. Okay, so what is basement membrane? So the epithelium and connective tissue. So epithelium is present. Beneath that, we have the connective tissue. So the junction in between the epithelium and connective tissue is formed by basal lamina. or the basement membrane. So if we view it under electron microscopic level, the terminology that we use is basal lamina. Under light microscopic level, we call it as basement membrane. So this basal lamina or basement membrane is the junction in between the epithelium and connective tissue. Okay, so this zone is 1 to 4 micrometer wide and it is not having any cells. Okay, so it is basal lamina is also same, basement membrane is also same. So it is cell free and it stains positively with periodic acid shift stain. Okay, so this basal lamina contains a lot of mucopolysaccharides. Because of these mucopolysaccharides, it will stain positively with PAS stain. Okay, so now this basal lamina, again, there are two parts, lamina lucida and lamina densa. So what we have seen, there is epithelium. Beneath that, we have basal lamina and here we have connective tissue. So in basal lamina, again, there are two layers, lamina lucida and lamina densa. Okay, so lamina lucida, where is it present? It is present beneath the epithelial layer, isn't it? So lamina lucida is present beneath the epithelial layer. And this lamina lucida is called as a clear zone. And it is 20 to 40 nanometer wide. Whereas lamina densa, where is it present? The lamina densa is present in between lamina lucida and the connective tissue. So the lamina lucida is present in between epithelium and lamina densa. Lamina densa is present in between lamina lucida and the connective tissue. Okay, this lamina densa is called as a dark zone. Okay, so here in the picture, you can see there is lamina lucida, lamina densa, and here to the lamina densa, we have anchoring fibrils. So these anchoring fibrils, which contain type 7 collagen, are looping. They are forming loops and they are getting attached to the lamina densa. Isn't it? So the anchoring fibrils are forming loops and they are getting attached to the lamina densa. So to these anchoring fibrils, again, there are type 1 and type 2 collagen fibrils that are intervening in between this anchoring fibrils. I hope it's clear. Okay, so to the lamina densa, anchoring fibrils which contain type 7 collagen are getting attached. Later, other collagen fibers of type 1 and type 2, they are even intervening. They are running around the loops of the anchoring fibrils. Here, an important point you need to remember is lamina lucida and lamina densa both contain type 4 collagen. This is very, very important. Lamina lucida and lamina densa contain type 4 collagen. And in lamina densa, as I told, there is type 4 collagen, right? So this type 4 collagen is coated by heparin sulfate. The type 4 in the lamina, type 4 collagen in the lamina densa is surrounded by heparin sulfate. This appears like a chicken wire appearance. This is the chicken wire appearance. Okay, that means a net-like configuration. The collagen is surrounded by heparin sulfate, which appears like a chicken wire appearance. Chicken wire or a net-like appearance. Okay? Yeah. So next, and the lamina lucida contains two important proteins that are the laminin and the bullous pemphigoid antigen. This you need to remember. So laminin and the bullous pemphigoid antigen. So what are the type? What is the type of collagen that is present in lamina lucida and densa? It is type 4 kind of collagen. Anchoring fibrils contain type 7 collagen. And the collagen fibers that are forming loops around the anchoring fibrils are containing type 1 and type 2, right? Yeah. So next is lamina propria. So what is lamina propria? Lamina propria is lamina propria is connective tissue. This is an MCQ. What is the connective tissue of the gingival epithelium called? It is the lamina propria. So in this lamina propria, there are two layers, the papillary layer and the reticular layer. Okay, so papillary layer is present in between. So here, this is the epithelium. Okay, so here in between the intervening portion of, so this is the epithelium. So this portion is connective tissue again, right? So this intervening portion is connective tissue. So now the connective tissue is projecting into the papillae. Can I say this? The connective tissue is projecting into the epithelium. This projections of the connective tissue are called as papillae. These projections of the connective tissue into the epithelium are called as papillae. What about epithelium? The epithelium is also dropping down into the connective tissue, right? So this dropping down, this epithelial projections into the connective tissue are called as epithelial ridges. So sometimes they are called as epithelial pegs, okay, retipegs. So epithelial pegs is actually not the term that we have to use. We have to use the term epithelial ridges. So epithelium, the portions of the epithelium that are entering into the connective tissue are called as epithelial ridges, whereas the portions of the connective tissue that are projecting into the epithelium are called as papillae. Okay, so now where is this papillary layer? This papillary layer is present in between the epithelial ridges and reticular layer. So this portion in between this projections is called as papillary layer. Beneath that we have the reticular layer. Okay, so now there is ground substance in the lamina propria. For anything, we have a ground substance, a base. So this ground substance of the lamina propria has a lot of glycoproteins and proteoglycans. So there are a lot of glycoproteins and the proteoglycans, out of which the important proteoglycans are hyaluronan, heparan sulfate, versicon, decorin, biglycan, and syndecan. These are the important proteoglycans that are present. Okay, so now the lamina propria contains type 1 and type 3 collagen. This is again an MCQ that is asked. Type 1 and type 3 kinds of collagen are present in lamina propria. So these types of collagen are to be remembered. You need to make a separate notes of it and by heart that. Okay, type 1 and type 3 are present in lamina propria. Okay, so now it's submucosa. So what is submucosa? Submucosa is attaching the mucous membrane to underlying structures like periosteum or bone. Okay, so this submucosa, as I have told you, it contains glands, it contains blood vessels, it contains nerves and adipose tissue. Okay, so it is containing blood vessels, right? So the blood supply to the oral mucosa is profuse when compared to the skin. When compared to the skin, the oral mucosa is having the greater blood supply, out of which the gingiva, out of all those oral mucosa has three different regions, right? The masticatory, lining and specialized, out of which gingiva is having the greatest blood supply. Remember this. Okay. And in this submucosa, in the submucosal layer, there are sensory nerves, sensory nerve endings. Okay. These sensory nerves are more in the anterior part of the mouth, especially in the rugae and in the tip of the tongue, right? So these sensory nerve endings, there are three types. So the specialized receptors for cold, they are called as Krause end bulbs. And for touch, we have the Meissner's corpuscles, and free nerve endings are present for pain perception. Okay. So in this submucosa, there are sensory nerve endings, out of which for cold, we have the Krause end bulbs. For touch sensation, we have the Meissner's corpuscles, and the free nerve endings are responsible for the pain perception. So where is the sensory sensation more? It is present in the anterior part of the tongue. That is the rugae and in the tip of the tongue. So in the functions of the oral mucosa, we have seen, right, the sensory function of oral mucosa. So the sensory function of the oral mucosa, we have the sensation to touch, pressure, pain, and temperature. Yes. So sensation of taste is more felt in the anterior two-thirds of the dorsum of the tongue. Okay. Yeah. So now we'll get into the structure of oral epithelium. So oral, we have the epithelium. Beneath that, we have the connective tissue. We have the basal lamina. We have the connective tissue, right? So now we'll study about this epithelial structure. So this epithelium is of stratified squamous variety. This you need to remember. So the oral epithelium is of stratified squamous variety. And as I have told you, the oral epithelium may be keratinized, parakeratinized or non-keratinized. Okay. So this, how can we say where it is keratinized or non-keratinized? So depending on the location, we'll study later which part of oral mucosa is keratinized or not. So we have three, just remember that there are three variations of the epithelium. It might be keratinized, non-keratinized or parakeratinized. Okay. Keratinized means the keratinization process is complete. Okay. So this is called as orthokeratinization. So keratinized or orthokeratinized is same. Parakeratinized, so partially keratinization is present. Non-keratinized, there is no keratinization. Okay, so what is the difference is, so here this is keratinized layer, keratinized epithelium. So here we have superficial cornified layer. cornified layer means the epithelium is keratinized. Okay. Whereas B, we have the non-keratinized one. Here, we have the surface layer. We do not have the cornified layer in the non-keratinized epithelium. There is surface layer and these will have nuclei. Here, you can see there is cornified layer. There are no nuclei. Okay, there are no cells present. Whereas here, in the non-keratinized epithelium, we have nuclei, cells with nuclei. So, cells with nuclei, cells retain their nuclei in case of non-keratinized epithelium. Whereas in case of parakeratinized, that means it is only partially keratinized. In this, the cells will retain pycnotic nuclei. That means cells will retain some amount of nucleus. Parakeratinized, cells will retain some amount of nucleus, which is called as pycnotic nucleus. Non-keratinized, cells will have full nucleus. Okay. Whereas keratinized, orthokeratinized or completely keratinized, these cells will not have nuclei. They won't retain nuclei. There is only a cornified cell layer. Okay, so now we'll talk about cytokeratins. Okay, so what are cytokeratins? Cytokeratins, they form the cytoskeleton of the epithelial cells. They are forming a skeleton for the cell. What is skeleton responsible for? It is important in maintaining cell shape. So because of the presence of cytoskeleton, there is certain shape to the cell. Okay, so it is forming not only the cytokeratins, along with this, we have the microfilaments and the microfibrils. Okay. So these cytokeratins are responsible for the process of keratinization. So we have seen something like keratinization, right? We'll discuss in detail later. So this keratinization to happen, we need this cytokeratins. Okay. And these cytokeratins, they are called as stress-bearing structures. So they bear the stress, most of the stress, and they will help in maintaining the cell shape. So these cytokeratins, they are called as intermediate filaments. This is again an important MCQ. The cytokeratins are called as intermediate filaments because their diameter is 7 to 11 nanometer, which is in between microtubules and microfilaments diameter. So these cytokeratins, they are forming the cytoskeleton along with microfilaments and microfibrils, right? So their diameter is in between that of microtubules and microfilaments. That is why intermediate. So the diameter is in between these two. That is why they are called as intermediate filaments. Whereas their molecular weight is 40 to 200 kilodalton. Okay. So this is greater than that of the microtubules and microfilaments. The diameter is lesser when compared, is in between that of the microtubules and microfilaments. Whereas the molecular weight is almost greater than that of the microtubules and microfilaments. Okay. So now there are 20 types of cytokeratins present, out of which type 1 and type 2. I mean, we majorly divide these 20 types of cytokeratins into two types. Okay. Two kinds. This is type 1 and type 2. Type 1 are called as basic cytokeratins, whereas type 2 kinds of cytokeratin are called as acidic cytokeratins. Okay. So type 1 is basic, type 2 is acidic. So cytokeratins number 1 to 8, 1, 2, 3, 4 to 8 belong to type 1, whereas from 9 to 20 we have type 2. Okay, so remember that cytokeratins will always appear in pairs. That means it will always combine with two types. There will be two, like one combining with two. If its pair is absent, then it won't function. It will be unstable. So whenever a cytokeratin is present, type 1, that means the cytokeratin number 1 will not be present alone. Okay, it will be combining with another type. Okay, that means CK1 and CK10 may be present. Okay, so it will always be in pair. Okay, if suppose CK10 is absent, then this CK1 will become unstable and it will get degraded. So always type 1 and type 2. Type 1 and type 2 will occur in pairs. Okay. So now this is the list of the cytokeratins present that is given in your Orban's textbook. So in case of masticatory mucosa suprabasal layers, we have 1 and 10. In case of lining mucosa suprabasal layers, we have 4 and 13. Ventral surface of the tongue, we have 5, 6 and 14. In the soft palate, we have the 7, 8 and 18. So for now, the question from the cytokeratin, especially of this aspect is not asked, but since it's given in organs, I wanted you all to introduce. Okay, so at the end, you can just bi-heart it. Okay, so 1 and 10 are present in the masticatory mucosa, 4 and 13 are present in the lining mucosa, 5, 6, 14 in the ventral surface of the tongue, and 7, 8, 18 on the soft palate. Okay, so now keratinized epithelium. Okay, so we have seen that there are three types: keratinized, orthokeratinized, and keratinized, non-keratinized, and parakeratinized. What is the major difference in between these three kinds of epithelium? The keratinization process, isn't it? So the keratinization is complete in case of orthokeratinized epithelium. It is only partially seen in parakeratinized epithelium, whereas the keratinization is not seen in case of non-keratinized epithelium. So here, in keratinized epithelium, where it is completely keratinized, we have four layers. These are the stratum basale. So the basal layer is called a stratum basale. Next, we have the stratum spinosum. Next, we have stratum granulosum. You need to remember this order. Next is called a stratum corneum. Stratum basale, spinosum, granulosum, and corneum. Now we'll see about each one. Okay. Yeah. So an important concept is, so the cells from the basal layer will start traveling towards the superficial layer. Okay. So this process, so these cells, the basal cells, so this is stratum basale, right? In the basal layer, there are cells which have the capacity to divide. Okay. So these cells have the capacity to divide, and these cells divide, and some cells may stay in the basal layer itself, while some cells, they migrate to the superficial layers. They undergo keratinization and they migrate to the superficial layer. Okay. So this is called as basale, spinosum, and granulosum. These names are given based on their morphologic appearance. Based on the morphologic appearance of cells present in each layer, this name is given. Okay. So in the basal layer, as I have told you, the cells in the basal layer divide, they undergo mitosis, and they may remain, some of the cells may remain in the basal layer itself, or they may become determined. What is the meaning of determined? They are determined to become keratinocytes. Okay, they are determined to undergo keratinization. Okay, so this you need to remember. The cells that are determined to keratinize are called as keratinocytes. Okay, the cells which do not have the ability to get determined are called as non-keratinocytes. Why are they getting keratinized? Because they have the cytokeratin filaments in them. Okay, so now from the basal layer, some cells are remaining in the basal layer itself, while other are getting determined. So in the process of getting determined, they will move from the basal layer to the superficial layer. Okay, so this process of cell migration from the basal layer to the surface layer is called as maturation. Okay, I hope you understand. So this process of migration of the cell from the basal layer to the corneal layer, stratum corneum is the superficial layer, right? So this process is called as maturation. And the time taken for the cell to divide and pass through the entire epithelium. So the cell is getting divided in the basal layer, later it is passing through the entire epithelium and it is reaching the superficial layer. This time is called as turnover time or the turnover rate. Okay. Yeah. So now we have the basic idea about the keratinized epithelium. There are four layers: basale, spinosum, granulosum, and corneum. Now we'll study about each layer. So stratum basale is the, it's present at the base, the last layer. Okay. So this layer is contacting the basal lamina. And beneath that we have the connective tissue. Okay. So stratum basale is having the cuboidal kind of cells. So the cells are cuboidal in shape and they synthesize DNA and undergo mitosis. So the cells are capable of dividing, right? So the cells, that the basal cells only have the capacity to divide. Okay. So stratum basale, stratum spinosum, right? So this basal layer and the parabasal spinous layer, that means the layer present above it is spinous layer. So parabasal, just above basal layer, there are some spinous cells. This basal layer cells and the parabasal spinous cells are referred to as stratum germinativum. Okay, they are referred to as stratum germinativum. But which are the cells that are capable of dividing? The basal cells are the only cells that are capable of dividing. Okay, and an important point is these basal cells show lot of organelles like ribosomes, mitochondria. So all these organelles are present in the basal layer. But as the cell moves from the basal layer to the superficial layer, these organelles will get reduced. Finally, what happens when it is cornified? The nucleus is lost. Okay, so basal layer, the cells in the basal layer will have lot of organelles like endoplasmic reticulum and mitochondria. Okay. So next, there are specialized structures called as hemidesmosomes, which abut the basal lamina. So what did we see? There is a connection in between the basal lamina and the stratum basal. So the epithelium is contacting the basement membrane, right? So the structures that are helping in establishing the connection in between the epithelium and the basement membrane are called as hemidesmosomes. So here you can see the stratum basal layer is connected to the basement membrane with the help of hemidesmosomes. Okay. Whereas the cells, the adjacent basal cells, that means these cells, cuboidal cells that are present, they are getting connected with the help of desmosomes. So the basal layer is connecting to basement membrane with the help of hemidesmosomes, whereas the connections in between the basal cells are called as desmosomes. Okay. So yeah. So next one is stratum spinosum. The cells in this layer are polyhedral in shape. So the cells in the stratum basal are cuboidal, whereas the stratum spinosum, the cells are polyhedral, but they are larger than the basal cells. So as we move to the superficial layer, the cell size increases. So they are larger than the basal cells. Okay. So these cells, the connections in between these cells are again desmosomes. Just like the basal cells are getting connected by desmosomes, the spinous cells are also getting connected by desmosomes. So these desmosomes are here called as intercellular bridges. Intercellular, they are present in between the cells. Okay, so this is called as spinosum because this layer appears, gives an appearance of prickly appearance. Okay, so prickle shaped cells. So what happens is these are the different cells. So here the intercellular space is more. So in between two cells, the space is more because of which In order for these two cells to connect, they are extending and they are forming a connection with the help of desmosomes, because of which they are giving a prickly appearance. So this is also called as cockle bur appearance. Okay, so just like these cells with spines, okay, this is a weed plant actually. So just like it is giving a spinous appearance, the stratum spinosum cells will also give this appearance. Why is this prickly appearance seen? Because the intercellular space is greater. Intercellular space is more. Whereas,
start preparing for the NEET MDS from your home. Dr. Pranab Academy of Dental Sciences. Online classes for all first, second, third, and final year students. NEET MDS online test series, unlimited practice, and highest quality teaching. Affordable pricing. Download the app
here. There is prickly appearance that is present in the stratum spinosum. So why is this prickly appearance present? Because the intercellular space is more in case of keratinized epithelium. So in case of keratinized epithelium, the intercellular space is more. Therefore, when the cell, both the cells are joining with the help of desmosomes, it is giving the shape of a spinous appearance, spinous cell appearance. Whereas in case of non-keratinized epithelium also, these cells are present, but there won't be the characteristic prickly appearance because the intercellular space is less in case of non-keratinized epithelium. And the stratum spinosum cells are most active in protein synthesis. Okay. So next is stratum granulosum. So this stratum granulosum, they have the flatter and wider kind of cells. And these cells are larger than the spinous cells. Okay, so the basals, the spinous cells are larger than the basal cells. And now the granulosum, the cells in the stratum granulosum are again larger than the spinous cells. A very important point is this stratum granulosum has basophilic keratohyaline granules. This is very, very important question. Keratohyaline granules are seen in stratum granulosum. Granulosum, so granules are present. So what is the name of the granules? Keratohyaline granules. Okay. So now there is again, there is small organelle that is present in the stratum granulosum layer. This is called as odland body or keratinosome or membrane coating granule. So these are all the other names. So the organelle that is present in stratum granulosum is called as odland body or keratinosome or membrane coating granule. So here you can see this. These are the odland bodies, or the they're also called as lamellar granules. Lamellar granules. So an important MCQ again is they originate from the Golgi system. These odland bodies or the keratinosomes, they originate from the Golgi system. So an important concept here is these organelles, these lamellar granules, they have lot of glycolipids. So they are made up of glycolipids. What they do is these lamellar granules, they will discharge their contents. So they will release their contents. What is their content? Their content is glycolipid. So they will release their content, and because of which there is this lining that is formed, this barrier that is formed, right? So this barrier is a permeability barrier, and this is made up of again glycolipids, isn't it? So this lamellar granules, which are containing glycolipids, they are discharging their content, because of which a barrier is formed. This barrier is a cornified cell envelope. So this barrier is called as cornified cell envelope. Okay, I hope it's clear. So now this keratohyaline granules. So these are present in the stratum granulosum layer. So the main protein that is responsible for the main protein that is making the, that is forming a major part of keratohyaline granules is filaggrin. This is again an important MCQ. So filaggrin is present in a major amount in case of keratohyaline granules. Whereas there are some other proteins like laurisin also, laurisin, involucrin also. So this filaggrin and laurisin, they are useful markers for epithelial differentiation. Whereas the involucrin, which is present, it contributes to the cornified cell envelope, which we have seen earlier. So the lamellar granules are discharging their contents, because of which a barrier is formed. So this involucrin is responsible for the formation of this cornified cell envelope. Okay. So involucrin on a major part, but there are some other proteins also involved. So I'll just give you the information. So other proteins involved are involucrin, periplakin and envoplakin. So these are the proteins. So all these proteins will form a cross-linking. They form a mesh-like structure, and they will result in the formation of the cornified cell envelope. Okay. So, yeah. So next one, the last, the superficial layer is called as stratum corneum. So what is present? The keratinization is complete, right? So there are keratinized squams that are present. So that layer is completely keratinized. So now what I told you, the stratum basale, the cells are having large amount of organelles. Whereas as the cells reach the superficial layer, the organelles will get reduced. So finally, when it comes to the corneal layer, the nuclei and other organelles will disappear. And the cells here are larger and flatter than the granular cells. So as we go superficial, the cell size is getting increased, and the organelles and the nuclei, they are getting reduced. Okay. So now orthokeratinization means the keratinization is completed. So we have the keratinized squams that are seen. Parakeratinization, the cells that are present in the superficial layer, they are retaining the pycnotic nuclei. They are retaining some amount of nuclei or the condensed nuclei and other partially lysed cell organelles. So partially keratinized, right? So there are some amount of cell organelles that are retained. Whereas in case of non-keratinized, the cells retain their nuclei. The organelles are present, cells retain their nuclei. Only in case of keratinization, the cells will lose their nuclei. Okay. So now, keratinocytes. What are keratinocytes? So the epithelial cells that ultimately keratinize are called as keratinocytes. So we are seeing that some cells from the basal, they are dividing. They are remaining in the basal layer itself, whereas others, they are getting determined to keratinize. They are moving to the superficial layer. So these cells that ultimately keratinize are called as keratinocytes. This is a very, very important question. The cells that are determined are called as keratinocytes. So what do they do to keratinize? They undergo cell division, right? They undergo mitosis. They mature and they finally desquamate. Okay. So now there is increase in volume in each successive layer from basal to granular layer. So in the basal layer, they divide. As they move to the superficial layer, they increase in their volume. Okay. So now non-keratinocytes. So non-keratinocytes, these are cells that are not getting determined to form to keratinize. Okay. So these are the smaller population of the cells that do not possess cytokeratin filaments. So as I have told you, the cytokeratin filaments are not present in this, because of which they do not have the ability to keratinize. So they are not having cytokeratin filaments, therefore they cannot keratinize. So keratinocytes are having the mitotic activity, they mature the discomate, whereas non-keratinocytes, there is no mitotic activity, they do not undergo any maturative changes, they do not discomate. And so we have seen that in case of the basal layer and all, the cells are joined, the cell-to-cell junctions are present by desmosomes, which are attached by desmosomes, whereas in case of non-keratinocytes, they do not form the desmosomal attachments with the adjacent keratinocytes. So there are no cell-to-cell connections, desmosomal connections in between these non-keratinocytes and the keratinocytes. Okay. So important question is, there are three types of non-keratinocytes. These are melanocytes, Merkel cells, and Langerhans cells. Melanocytes, Merkel cells, and Langerhans cells, remember. Okay. So these three are different types of non-keratinocytes. Okay. So first we'll start with melanocytes. So in the name itself, we see melanocytes. So these cells are responsible for the synthesis of melanin. Okay. So now, yeah. So these cells arise embryologically from the neural crest epithelium. So this is a direct question that is asked. Melanocytes arise from the neural crest epithelium. And these cells will lack desmosomes and tonofilaments. They do not have the desmosomal junctions. They do not have the tonofilaments. And we all know this, melanin is synthesized within the melanocytes. So these cells have dendritic processes. Remember this, melanocytes have dendritic processes. Dendritic means nothing but tree-like. So it has branching. Okay. So what happens is, this melanocyte, it will get connected with, it will contact keratinocytes. So it branches, it's a tree-like, it's dendritic, right? So it will contact with around 30 to 40 keratinocytes. So one melanocyte forms a connection with 30 to 40 keratinocytes. So what is inside the melanocyte? Melanin is inside the melanocytes, right? Melanin is inside the melanocytes. What this melanocyte will do is, it will transfer this melanin to the keratinocyte. It is forming connection, right, with 30 to 40 keratinocytes. So this melanocyte is now transferring the melanin that is present in it to the keratinocytes. Okay, clear? So this, and what happens is this, there are some certain cells, macrophages, which will phagocytose this melanin pigment. So what happens is, the melanocyte, which is containing melanin, is transferring to the keratinocyte. So sometimes what happens, there will be melanin that is dispersed in the connective tissue. This melanin pigment might get dispersed in the connective tissue. So this melanin that is getting dispersed in the connective tissue is eaten away, is phagocytosed by macrophages. These macrophages that are eating away, that are phagocytosing away the melanin, are called as melanophages. They are eating the melanin, right? So they are called as melanophages. So melanocytes, they are arising from the neural crest epithelium. They do not have desmosomes and tonofilaments. They synthesize the melanin, and they have the dendritic processes. One melanocyte will form a connection with 30 to 40 keratinocytes, and it will transfer the melanin to the keratinocytes. Some melanin may get dispersed in the connective tissue, which is eaten away by melanophages. Okay. So here you can see this. Yeah. Next is Merkel cells. Okay. So Merkel cells, they are called as neurosensory cells. Okay. So they have the sensation. So they are called as neurosensory cells, and they have the neural pressure sensitive receptor cells in them. Okay. So they have the nerve tissue immediately beneath them. So you can see the picture, right? So here is a nerve axon. So beneath the Merkel cells, there is a nerve cell that is present in between, because of which it is a neural pressure sensitive receptor cell. So what is it responding to? It is responding to touch sensation. Okay. So an important point is, it is not dendritic. So it does not produce a branching appearance like melanocytes. So Merkel cells are not dendritic, and they are common in the masticatory mucosa and they are absent in the lining mucosa. An important question is, it's a neural pressure sensitive receptor cells. It responds to touch sensation. In the questions, it is asked as Merkel cell is neurosensory. So this you need to remember straight away. So Merkel cell is neurosensory. So here you can see that the nucleus is having, the nucleus is molded. It is indented and there are dense granules that are present. So there are lot of granules that are present inside the Merkel cells. Okay. So next one is Langerhans cells. So what all we have seen in the non-keratinocytes, melanocytes, Merkel cells and Langerhans cells. So this Langerhans cells, it is called as a high level clear cell. So actually the non-keratinocytes, the other name is called as clear cell. Non-keratinocytes are also called as clear cells, out of which the Langerhans cell is a high level clear cell. And this Langerhans cell is responsible for the immune response. Suppose the bacterial plaque gets accumulated on the teeth. So once the bacterial plaque is a foreign material, it's an antigenic material, right? So this Langerhans cell will produce antigens and it will present the bacteria to the lymphocytes. So it plays a very important role in immune response. So how is it functioning? It is functioning similar to macrophages by picking up the antigen and presenting it to lymphocytes. Okay. So now it has some granules which are called as Birbeck granules. So here you can see these rod-shaped granules which are present in the Langerhans cells. So it has a convoluted nucleus and it has characteristic rod-like granules which are called as Birbeck granules. And this Langerhans cell is only present in the areas of orthokeratinized areas. That means only in the epithelium, which is completely keratinized, there only we have this Langerhans cell. So Langerhans cell, if there are, it is picking up the antigens. So if there is any bacterial plaque that is present, this what does this Langerhans cell do? It will migrate to the gingiva, it will move to the epithelium and it will pick up the antigens and it will present to the lymphocytes. So its function is similar to macrophages. Okay. So with this, we finished the keratinized epithelium. We studied about keratinocytes. We studied about non-keratinocytes. Whereas now coming to non-keratinized epithelium. So we already know that non-keratinized epithelium, there is no keratinization process. So there will be no stratum corneum, right? The superficial layer is not cornified. So there is no stratum corneum. And there won't be stratum granulosum also. So in case of keratinized epithelium, what are the layers? Stratum basal, spinosum, granulosum, and corneum, right? So there is no granulosum, no basal layer. But here in non-keratinized epithelium, we have three layers. Stratum basal is present, stratum intermedium is present, and stratum superficial is present. Basal, intermediate, and superficial layer. Okay. So in stratum intermedium, we have the spinous cells. Okay. But they have, since the intercellular space is very less, we do not have that characteristic prickly kind of appearance. Okay. Yeah. So this, I'll talk about some important points that are mentioned in your MCQs now. So in case of gingiva and hard palate, we have long connective tissue papillae and these are keratinized. So connective tissue papillae are the projections into the epithelium. So the projections of the connective tissue into the epithelium are called as papillae, right? So this long connective tissue papillae are present in gingiva and hard palate, whereas in case of alveolar mucosa, the papillae are quite low. Okay, the extensions are quite less. Okay, so next is, there are some subdivisions of oral mucosa. So we all know it may be keratinized, it may be non-keratinized, right? So in keratinized, we have the masticatory mucosa and vermilion border of lip. You need to remember this table. In keratinized, we have the masticatory mucosa, that is the gingiva and hard palate, and vermilion border of the lip. Whereas non-keratinized areas include the lining mucosa and the specialized mucosa. So this question is asked, lining mucosa is non-keratinized, gingiva and hard palate or the masticatory mucosa is keratinized, okay? So, you know, what are all the different layers that are present in keratinized and non-keratinized epithelium? Okay. So now comes, this is again an MCQ that is asked. So this table, I have taken it from your dental pulse. So sensitivity of the lips and oral mucosa. So the sensitivity, the sensation to pain is greatest in these regions, lips, pharynx, base of the tongue and teeth. It is moderate in anterior tongue and gingiva, It is least in buccal mucosa. So some of this area can be asked. It can be taken, like the ventral tongue is least responsive to heat. So it might be asked in some way. So you need to remember this whole table. So to heat, the greatest sensation is by the lips. Anterior teeth shows moderate sensation, whereas the ventral tongue and palate shows the least sensation. To cold, lips and posterior palate show the greatest sensation. Base and ventral tongue show the moderate sensation, whereas the dorsum tongue and the buccal mucosa show the least sensation. To touch, again, we have the lips, tip of the tongue and anterior palate showing the greatest sensation. Moderate is shown by the gingiva. Least is shown by the base of the tongue and buccal mucosa. Here you can remember is for everything, the greatest sensation is shown by the lips. To pain, heat, cold and touch, lips we have the common point. Okay. Yeah. So next is collagen types. So this is the last one. We have already discussed this, the types of collagen. In case of anchoring fibrils, we know that type 7 collagen is present, right? In case of basement membrane, we have the type 4 collagen. Reticular fibers, we have type 3. Cartilage, we have type 2. And in case of bone, gingiva and principal fibers of periodontal ligament, the major part is formed by type 1. So you need to remember this collagen types. Another point given in your dental pulse is, so type 7, if the type 7 is deficient, the syndrome that is seen is called as Alport syndrome. Whereas type 4 collagen is deficient in Ehlers-Danlos. Type 3 is deficient in Ehlers-Danlos type 4. Ehlers-Danlos type 4. Okay. So yeah, thank you everyone.